much. Sharing my screen. Can you see it?
We can see it.
Awesome. Thank you for having me here. And just a quick introduction to who I am. I'm Anna. I've been working with OpenCV since 2011, and I have been a part of the community. And now I run some things in OpenCV community too, and OpenCV board. I also run a for-profit arm of OpenCV that is called OpenCV.ai, where I had a privilege to look at how different companies, big and small, do their data pipelines. And I'm the CEO of CVAT.ai, where we built the open source data platform to help companies create meaningful and highly used pipelines in artificial intelligence. So I'm going to talk how I see the trend in data annotation, what I see changing, and what I see is developing in the area. So previously, working with data was always viewed as kind of one stream, a single stream. You work with the data, you compile your data set, pretty big, diverse, and meaningful. You annotate it, you train a model on top of that, you deploy it to the production, being server or embedded device, and then you are done. It's great. You can forget about how much data you collected and how you annotated that. You can forget about the processes that you use there and just, you know, enjoy your life. It's not how it is right now. So for organizations that rely on artificial intelligence as a core of their business or as something that really accelerates their pipelines, in all these organizations, there is a significant paradigm shift right now. Instead of having kind of doing it one time and forgetting about that, people started to understand that once you deploy it into the production, you start collecting something that is called hard negatives. And you collect them all the time. You then put them into your data annotation process. You create them, manage your data set. You understand what are its strong parts and its weaknesses using tools like Voxel 51, for example. Then you train it, train your model on it. You deploy it into the production just to start it once again, just to keep collecting the data over and over. Now, you probably heard from people, for example, Andrei Karpathy, who previously was running the Tesla Autopilot, that data is significantly more important in real life production use cases than it was previously seen in when he was working in academia. So it's way more complex. You need to collect a lot of data to make sure that the car doesn't kill anybody, and because of that, data is like really important. So because of that, people started moving from, you know, doing something quick and getting the results fast in terms of the data annotation and the management process towards building real pipelines on this side and relying on tools that people know that will be developed further and further because they will be, you know, getting back to these tools more than one time back. And because of that, there is this shift towards understanding that when you collected the data, it's not the last time. So people typically think about that as, you know, first chunk of the data and follow-on chunks. They're different. First chunk, you want still to have it like very big and meaningful and diverse and everything. Typically, depending on your task, it's from 3,000 to like 30,000 images. And it typically covers like 70% of your use case. When you deploy it into real life, it should work. You can never rely to, you know, your follow-on chunks that fix the problems. So you should just do your job correctly. But after it is done, you want to collect these hard negatives to keep fixing these 30% of the business cases that you have never kind of predicted beforehand. So an example that I like is from working with a company that embedded thermal sensors into indoor environments on the ceilings to understand how people use the space and specifically to count how many people are in the room. Now, when we first collected the data and created the data set, annotated it, we were able to train a model that performed very well. But we kept collecting the data that we did not see was, you know, even needed. For example, we did not understand that in thermal, when you collect thermal data, you actually need to care about things like refrigerators or desktop computers that, you know, are very hot at times. Open windows and doors that introduce other temperature into the room and stuff like that. So this is why we kept collecting the data. Now, the second trend that I see is going beyond 2D images and videos towards new modalities of the data. Now, there is an abundance of LiDAR data available. For example, because iPhones have LiDAR data and other smartphones also have LiDAR data sensors right now. Because there are more and more autonomous car developers out there that are really interested into understanding the semantics of the world in 3D. This is the image on the left that you can see. It's actually from CVAT.ai site, where we visualize how CVAT works with the 3D cuboids. Like, people are really interested in annotating 3D boxes around cars and around pedestrians, as you can see here in real life. Now, another type of data that people are also interested in is data from radars, from satellites. The image in the middle shows that. It's actually an image from the satellite that is equipped with a radar and can sense the landscape on the Earth in 3D. So it actually understands the height, not only the not only how it looks, but also understands the height of the point on the Earth. And the next image here shows the result of MRI, a medical procedure, where right now the tools are mostly, they mostly show kind of slices in 2D, but it actually makes a lot of sense to treat them as 3D data for a lot of things, for example, for algorithms that work to detect some abnormalities in this data. So 3D data is not that supported in data area and data annotation area right now, but this is actually something that we are working in CVAT.ai on, and you can expect our updates in the next couple of months. Please stay tuned. We hope to start solving these things in a big way. CVAT has already support for 3D cuboids, as you can see on the image on the left, but we want to make sure that more and more types of data are supported in a very easy way to work with. So the next thing that I see in the area is treating annotator as a real profession. So what happened when there was an AI boom, and even before that, there was no such profession. There was no such specific kind of teams of people or data or like business units who would do that. And data scientists were the people who were actually taking care of the data sets. This is something that is still out there. Some data scientists are still annotating their own data sets, but this is a very rare case that is basically disappearing from the life. When data scientists are annotating their own data, on one side, this is good because they are very intimate with it. They understand its structure and stuff like that. But on the other hand, data scientists are expensive and their brains are better utilized in other areas of work. So companies started to understand that they should create in-house teams or rely on third parties to annotate their data, which led to actually just bigger amounts of data that are used in data sets. Because when you use an in-house team or a data agency or rely on crowdsourcing, you can annotate way more data than by a single or just a couple of data scientists on the team. So, even though data scientists still annotate their data, in most of the companies that rely on artificial intelligence as their core businesses, they rely on either in-house teams or third parties. Now, there is a huge number of data agencies, companies that are specifically targeted to data annotation, this area has significantly grown in the last couple of years. And there is also a big growth in tools for crowdsourcing out there. So for example, in Amazon Mechanical Turk, you can create a task for large crowds of people to annotate it all around the world, the globe, and then to validate that this work was done correctly, to, you know, somehow average the predictions of different people and do some procedures to actually validate that people were not just doing it quickly for money, but rather they were doing meaningful job on the data. Another value that is happening in crowdsourcing is actually Web3. So Web3 actually aligns very well with this area of, you know, doing something in a very distributed manner. CVAT works with a company called Human Protocol that creates a protocol blockchain that is targeted specifically at that. So CVAT is going to be deployed as a tool that is used for big crowds all around the world that annotate on blockchain. In the future, I see that this is going to be a very big area that is just going to like be developing more and more. But I don't think that it's going to completely replace in-house teams or data agencies. The reason why I think is, first, there are specific types of data that cannot be annotated by crowds or even specific agencies. For example, medical data. To annotate medical data, you need a doctor. So there are agencies that are compiled with specific people with a degree, with a medical degree, who would be able to annotate, for example, abnormalities on MRI scan. But this is rare. This is mostly done in in-house teams still. Second reason is an in-house team still provides way more control around the quality of the data annotation than data agency or crowdsourcing. But things are changing there for sure. More and more processes are implemented there to ensure the quality of the data, not only the speed and cost efficiency. So I think that these three types, in-house teams, data agencies, and crowdsources, are going to be coexisting. But I think that the crowdsources is going to take more of its pie in future. Next thing is moving to open source. You all know about Voxel 51 and 51, which is a very popular open source tool. We from CVAT are also working on GitHub. CVAT was open source back in 2018 and is one of the most popular repos on GitHub in data area. We have thousands of people who are actually building on top of CVAT. We have a lot of works, and we see that people are actually doing very, very meaningful things and implementing their own specific buttons that work for their specific workflow. And we are super happy to have that, because not only this is a sign that, you know, people use CVAT, and it's always great for a developer to know that something is being used, but the community also keeps reporting and developing new features for CVAT and committing them to us, which is incredible, really incredible. So what I see happening in industry is open source tools start to be on par or even more popular than enterprise solutions. The reason why companies big and small choose open source tools instead of closed source enterprise solutions is they want to have a full control on the code that they are using and the tool that they are using. They want to be able to customize it in some way, maybe even in future. They don't need it right now, but they want to know that in future they will be able to customize it without having to replace the tool. And they also want to be sure that the tool is going to continue working and being out there and being supported no matter what happens with the business. Because with enterprise solutions, it's not like that. So open source is great, and then open source is going to be bigger and bigger in data industry. And the last trend that I see that is actually very similar to the first one that I was talking about is that people keep building more complex and more meaningful data flows and flexible integrations. So because people understand that they are not going to be working with data just one time, they are going to be returning to that more and more. They want to make sure that there is a whole pipeline around them that they can rely to. And they are building their data flow that is, you know, very different for every company. There are no two similar, like same data flows, but they're building it from tools like CVAT, Voxel 50, like 51. They connect the tools via APIs. They create a flexible system that can support vast loads of data that they can iterate on. So this is what I see more and more. Previously, like back in 2015, it was mostly, you know, some manual operation, like very manual operation, where people would just, you know, name their versions of the data, like version 1, version 1 edited, version 2, version 4, stuff like that. It was like completely manual. It's not what I see right now happening in the industry. And there is a big, meaningful and kind of mature step towards having reliable data flows available to you at any time. So these are the five trends that I see happening in the industry. Iterations on the data, more data modalities, better data flows and flexible integration, open source, and annotation being a real profession out there. And I would be super happy to answer your question.
So it looks like we do have one question that popped up in the chat, so I'll just go ahead and read it out. Is that, what is the popular annotations format? So I'm assuming this is in context to the final slide.
Yeah, sure. I mean, there is a lot of them, and they very much depend on the type of the data and type of the annotation that you're working with. For example, if we are talking about bounding boxes, probably the most popular format is COCO format that encodes the coordinates of the bounding boxes on each image. There are other formats for data, for segmentation, for polygon annotation, for annotation in 3D, so it like very much depends. You can actually check the supported formats in CVAT in our README on GitHub, and it will give you a very good idea on it.
And then there are two additional questions in the Q&A, although I don't think they're questions. I think they're more like comments, they're from Kendall. Yay, drop for remote sensing. I'm a geospatial engineer. So I think they're more comments than they are questions, but I'll let you take a look at the Q&A. So if you have any additional questions for Anna, please make sure to ask those in the Q&A. Looks like we just had another one. Is there version control for annotations?
Yeah, definitely. So there are several tools for data versioning. My favorite one is called DVC, Data Version Control. You might want to take a look. It's also a fellow open source tool out there.